Located on the eastern flank of the Canadian Rockies, Nakiska is the closest major ski mountain to the city of Calgary. The resort isn't that well known to those who don't live in the region, but it has one of the most interesting histories of any North American ski resort, having only been developed in the first place due to the need for a 1988 Calgary Winter Olympics venue. Nakiska brings over 600 acres of terrain and offers high-speed lifts, but developing a ski resort for the Olympics is not the same as developing a ski resort for the general public. So is Nakiska an actual practical option for a destination ski vacation? Well, in this video, we'll go through Nakiska's overall mountain experience, and then we'll go through how the resort stacks up in our overall rankings. If you find this information helpful, be sure to like and subscribe and hit the bell so you don't miss any of our content. And if you haven't already, be sure to subscribe to our newsletter and follow us on Instagram, TikTok, and Twitter, where you'll find exclusive content you won't see in our videos. And special thanks to Skier72, who helped out with various parts of this script and provided a few pieces of footage later on in the video. You can check out his channel, which focuses on telling the stories of abandoned ski resorts, by clicking the link in the description below. With that all being said, let's jump in. Thanks to its Canadian Rockies location, Nakiska finds itself nestled alongside some of the tallest peaks in Canada. However, the resort itself, at least in its current iteration, is located entirely below treeline, with the ski area boundary stopping just painfully short of the alpine bowls on its host mountain. As a result, while guests will enjoy unmistakable views of above treeline terrain, including some particularly stunning peaks, they won't be able to actually ski on these tantalizingly close bowls. But on the plus side for those who appreciate natural beauty, Nakiska sits in the protected Kananaskis Country Area, and despite its proximity to Alberta's largest metropolitan area, there's almost non-existent buildup in the vicinity surrounding the resort. Across its 663-acre skiable footprint, Nakiska can essentially be split into three terrain zones: the lower mountain, which is served by the silver and Olympic chairs; the upper mountain, which is served by the gold chair; in a small beginner-oriented learning area, served by the bronze chair. With the exception of the bronze double chair, every lift at Nakiska is a high-speed quad, making for fast and pleasant uphill transportation. Despite its strong appeal to regional families, Nakiska isn't the best mountain in the world for beginners. Besides the bronze chair learning area, green runs within the resort's boundaries are quite limited. The resort only has one green route from each of the lower mountain lifts, and they merge into one singular green trail about a third of the way down that runs all the way to the base. These trails get incredibly congested, making for less than ideal learning conditions. When it comes to the upper mountain area served by the gold chair, no green trails exist at all. Nakiska becomes a much better mountain for guests who have reached intermediate proficiency. The resort is chock full of modestly pitched groomed cruisers, with tons of options to choose from off both the silver and gold chairs. While these runs can get busy, they rarely see the same level of congestion as Nakiska's greens. The upper mountain is also home to intermediate level glade terrain, making for a unique environment to spend time in the trees. Nakiska is no match for Western Canada's toughest resorts, but perhaps surprisingly, it does hold its own decently well when it comes to advanced terrain. The upper mountain calls home to a range of respectably steep groomers and demanding bump runs, with even a few chutes hidden within the trees. Nakiska's four double black diamond expert trails aren't as tough as the truly extreme runs at some resorts further west, but they are by no means easy either, involving particularly steep fall lines and obstacles such as thin cover and rocks. Speaking of thin cover, since the Olympics that spearheaded its existence, Nakiska has primarily transformed into a race training-oriented mountain, and trail maintenance gets prioritized accordingly. As a result, trails that are not important for this purpose tend to get deprioritized for grooming and snowmaking attention. This wouldn't be a huge deal at some of Nakiska's best-known competitors. After all, many destinations in the Canadian Rockies receive plenty of snow each season and can get their terrain open even without snowmaking. However, Nakiska sits in somewhat of a snow shadow compared to destinations like Banff Sunshine, Revelstoke, and Lake Louise, and accordingly cannot always offer a reliable base without artificial snow. This, combined with hit-or-miss snowmaking on trails that aren't designed for racing, means that a notable portion of Nakiska's footprint is subject to variable openings throughout the season. Nakiska's expert-rated terrain takes the longest to fill in, and these trails rarely open prior to mid-January. The resort also primarily faces east, meaning it's much more susceptible to icy conditions than its larger, northwest-facing competitors further in the mountains. Nakiska isn't going to be half closed by late January or early February, and it's still much more reliable than most resorts east of the plains, but when it comes to slope consistency, there are better options out there. This all being said, Nakiska does have one thing going for it snow-wise, and that's its predisposition to late-season upslope storms. These storms, which usually only occur a handful of times per season in late March or early April, come from the east and dump on Nakiska, often without even making it to the Canadian Rockies Mountains further west. On the rare spring days when these storms roll through, the resort may actually offer the best conditions in the region. Nakiska's Olympics-derived history also results in some of the weirdest quirks of any ski resort we've ever visited. Remember how we mentioned that Nakiska is entirely below treeline? If that's the case, why is there an above treeline platter lift that starts at the top of the gold chair? Well, it turns out that while you can't ride it now, this platter provided access to the men's downhill course during the 1988 Olympics, serving a small amount of high alpine bowl terrain in the process. The terrain served by the platter is never open to the general public, and on paper, it never has been. In the early 90s, the resort would run the platter, and while it technically wasn't allowed, you could get away with riding up the lift. Nowadays, though, the resort will pull your pass if you even try to hike up that terrain. There's no official reason why the resort has been so adamant about keeping this lift close to the public, but various reasons we've heard include notable avalanche risk and a sensitive mountain goat roaming area. But why, you might be asking, does this lift even still exist? Well, it turns out that the answer has to do with ski patrol. Patrollers still use this lift for what they say is avalanche mitigation work, allowing the resort to conduct controlled slides in high alpine areas that would otherwise affect terrain openings lower down within the resort boundary. If you visit Nakiska after a bout of recent snow, you might even see it running as patrollers make their way up this now abandoned terrain zone. Or, in other words, if you want to ski or ride Nakiska's limited bowl terrain, the only way to do it now is to become a patroller. But the high alpine platter is not the only permanently closed area at Nakiska. There are also some notably abandoned tree-cut trails in upper mountain areas. These include the upper parts of the North Axe and Grant Trunk Trails, which sit off a closed, very narrow cat track off the gold chair. Upper North Axe was the start of the women's downhill course in the 1988 Olympics, while Upper Grant's Trunk provided an alternate route down, but never hosted any courses. It's clear that both of these trails were once maintained, with remnants of snowmaking pipes scattered throughout both trails, and an abandoned shack located off of Upper North Axe. Like with the bowl terrain off the platter, neither of these trails ever officially opened to the public following the Olympics. But unlike the platter, Ski Patrol will open and close these two trails depending on snow conditions, and will perform control operations on them if they are open. And even if Ski Patrol doesn't drop the rope on the cat track, small portions of these trail segments are still technically in bounds, so you can hike to access them if you want. But if you do duck the cat track rope when it's closed, Ski Patrol can and will pull your pass, just as they would with the platter terrain. Upper North Axe is still relatively clear of obstacles, and it's similar in pitch to some of Nakiska's other ungroomed double black terrain. Upper Grain's Trunk is much more grown in, and is more technically challenging than Upper North Axe due to the growth. If you do end up at Nakiska on a day when Ski Patrol opens these runs, be sure to check them out if you're a proficient enough skier or rider, because they offer some of the best views at the resort and add a distinct flavor to the ski area experience. Nakiska is an easy escape from Calgary, sitting just under an hour away from the closest parts of Canada's fourth largest metropolitan area. But this proximity results in notable crowds, especially during peak times. During weekends and holidays, guests should expect waits of up to half an hour on the lower mountain lifts. Nakiska also recently removed about half the chairs from the Olympic lift, which puts additional strain on that area during busy times. That being said, if you know what you're doing, Nakiska's lines are somewhat avoidable. The resort tends to attract families, so while general lift lines might be crazy, the singles lines almost never have a wait. Since most guests are day trippers, lines are worst in the late morning and early afternoon, so if you aim for early morning or late afternoon skiing, you probably won't be waiting all that much. And finally, since Nakiska's clientele skews towards beginners and low intermediates, the lines for the upper mountain gold chair, which serves the more advanced terrain, are usually pretty manageable. But one aspect of Nakiska's traffic that's a bit harder to manage is its on-mountain facility setup. The resort includes a base lodge and a mid-mountain restaurant near the top of the Olympic chair, but guests will struggle to find space in these lodges during peak times. If you plan to stop for lunch at Nakiska, we'd advise you to do so either before or after the peak time 11:30 to 1:30 rush to secure a seat. We'd also recommend you bring your own food, because Nakiska's lodge options are incredibly pricey, especially for the quality. At least as you're exploring the mountain, it's fairly easy to get around Nakiska's modestly sized footprint. The resort employs clear trail and lift signage at major junction points, and guests can get to the upper mountain gold chair from either lower mountain lift. With the exception of the bronze chair served learning area, every trail at the resort filters back to the main base, so it's tough to end up in the wrong spot at the end of the day. Located about an hour from central Calgary, Nakiska is the closest ski resort to the city of over 1 million people. There is no public transportation to Nakiska, so most guests will need to drive in order to reach the resort. Since Nakiska is located in the Kananaskis country, visitors will need to purchase a $15 conservation pass to park at the resort, which is fairly expensive for a ski area of its size. Parking pass compliance is strictly monitored by park officials, so don't try to get away with skipping this fee. There is no on-site lodging at Nakiska, although a few towns do exist within a shorter driving distance than Calgary. The town of Kananaskis hosts some high-end hotels with stunning mountain views, but these options tend to be expensive with limited inventory, although the Kananaskis Wilderness Hostel is the notable exception here. About half an hour away from Nakiska, there's also the town of Canmore. This area hosts a much wider array of hotel options than Kananaskis Village, and it also sits surrounded by some really stunning peaks. Canmore's hotel and inn options especially make sense for those on a budget, but there are some higher-end accommodations as well. Calgary, of course, offers an extensive array of options if you're traveling from out of town, but you won't be getting the ski town atmosphere if you're staying there. Nakiska is a day trip, family-oriented mountain, and Aprés-Ski options are essentially non-existent. There's an on-site restaurant, but that's about as rowdy as it gets. If Aprés is a priority after your day at Nakiska, try to check out Banff, which is about an hour away. But at that point, you might want to consider skiing or riding at one of the resorts in that vicinity instead. So Nakiska offers convenient skiing and riding close to Calgary, and higher quality terrain than a typical local ski hill. But the resort is no match for competing destinations further west in the Canadian Rockies, which offer better snow, much larger footprints, true ski towns, and fewer crowds. Nakiska might be worth stopping by if you're on a Canadian Rockies road trip and have intermediates in your group, and it might be cool to check out if you're a Winter Olympics history junkie, but for the typical fly-to vacationer, the resort just doesn't make sense. Nakiska's lift tickets are fairly reasonable for what you get, but particularly on weekends and holidays, they're not that much cheaper than the resort's much better Canadian Rockies competition. The resort is on the Epic Pass, but only the full version, and if you buy an Epic Day Pass product, you need to buy 4 days or more of the top tier version to get Nakiska access. Now let's go through how Nakiska stacks up in our overall rankings, which are determined by the following 10 category mountain score. Nakiska doesn't see the highest accumulation totals in the world, but still offers decent quality thanks to consistently cold temperatures, and the resort gets a 7 for snow. Nakiska is more reliable than resorts east of the Rockies, but it still sees some conditions variability in part due to the way it prioritizes snowmaking, and the resort gets a 6 for resiliency. Nakiska claims a 1,021-acre footprint, but based on our measurements, only 663 of these acres are skiable, and the resort gets a 4 for size. Nakiska has some solid intermediate and advanced terrain for its size, but it's still a very plain mountain compared to other options in the Canadian Rockies, and the resort gets a 4 for terrain diversity. While it's generally family-friendly, Nakiska has some genuinely hard tree and bump runs if you know where to look, and the resort gets a 5 for challenge. Nakiska's lifts are on the older side, but they're almost entirely high speed, and the resort gets an 8 for lifts. Nakiska gets packed on weekends and holidays, but you can avoid the lines if you know what you're doing, and the resort gets a 5 for crowd flow. Nakiska's base and mid-mountain lodges are fairly pleasant, but they're not big enough to satisfy demands on busy days, and the resort gets a 5 for facilities. Nakiska is a fairly straightforward mountain to get around with pretty good signage, and the resort gets an 8 for navigation. And finally, mountain aesthetic. While Nakiska isn't the largest ski area out there and gets really packed with city folks on busy days, the resort does offer some pretty incredible views of surrounding mountains. The abandoned trails are really cool if you know what they are, and they're probably not a huge detractor from the feel if you don't, and the resort gets a 6 in this category. These categories add up to an overall score of 58, placing Nakiska 14th in Western Canada as of March 2024. Nakiska has a couple of things going for it, including fast lifts and an easy-to-navigate footprint, but it really can't compete with the true destinations when it comes to size, terrain diversity, challenge, and the quality and maintenance of snow conditions. While some folks might be considering Nakiska for a multi-day vacation, the resort just doesn't offer the overall experience to justify a visit that isn't day trip in nature, especially when there are so many world-class mountains, mind you, at lift ticket rates that aren't too much higher and parking rates that are often less expensive, just a little bit further into the mountains. For more information on Nakiska and over 100 ski resort destinations in Canada, the United States, and elsewhere around the world, check out peakrankings.com. See you for the next one.